What we seem to have been talking about in the last few minutes is the extension of the framework within the toolkit and in the context of descriptions for context or for particular languages.
Yes.
So the RLD context or the expansion of the functional descriptors, which are now arising out of need.
Yes.
The other, I think, framework-related tool or set of tools, which has been very influential, are those to do with focusing on aligning materials to the framework, particularly in the context of assessment. And we have a plethora, actually, now of documentation and resources which can be downloaded from the Council of Europe's framework. We have a manual for aligning examinations, supported by exemplar materials. We have grids for analysing the content of materials and helping to work out the relationship between the framework categories. What else do we have? We have several essays about the nature of standard setting, including a reference document in the supplementary materials to the manual. And recently, I think, and importantly, we have a new manual called the Manual for Test Development and Examining, which has been making the sometime forgotten point that we alluded to earlier, that you have to produce high quality assessment before you can align it to anything. You can't align a test which is functioning like a rubber band to any kind of fixed reference points.
Yes.
And so I think we are seeing, if you like, as you suggested, the evolution of the application and the toolkit taking place. What other tools do you think might emerge from that process?
Well, I find it difficult to foresee them. I think that the ones you mentioned have been logical requirements arising from need.
Mm.
I think that the emergence of others will come as a response to emerging needs, and which are will come out of people attempting to deal with the requirements of their own in a professional situation. And they may come from many different quarters,
right.
Some of which probably are unforeseen.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want any professionals working in the language field to feel themselves oppressed or constrained in what they can do by the existence of the framework.
Mm-hmm.
I rather see it the other way round, that they should use all the knowledge and understanding that they have to solve the problems of their own environment, using the framework if it helps in that process, and feeding the results of it back into the general body.
Mm-hmm.
Of enlightened practice, which may then require will certainly enrich the body of knowledge and understanding centered on the framework, and very likely involve the modification of the framework, or people may feel eventually that they want to get together under the aegis of some overarching body, or just themselves, to produce something new.
I see.
That I don't see as something to be resisted, and I think it's something to be welcomed.
That's something for the future, and that's something which will come out naturally from the need as it arises.
Yes.
In the meantime, I think if you were to summarise, if I were able to summarise what you've just said, it seems to me that you are somewhat happy with the way that the framework has continued to be adapted and adopted over the last 10 years, provided that the resources that are available and the information that's provided is followed or at least referred to in appropriate ways. The toolkit is perhaps the area which is evolving fastest, and the strength of the framework as a reference point is that it remains somewhat static, at least in its core, but that when necessary and where the need is felt, evolution is taking place. So in the descriptors for different audience groups, for example. In the future, if this carries on and the framework still is relevant, the users will perhaps come up with a different way of thinking, which might perhaps throw it out completely, or might reinterpret what was first done in a way which is not predicted at the moment from the current process of evolution.
Well, as I said earlier on, I think that a lot of effort will be redirected towards a formal linguistic organisation and the establishment of progression in that dimension.
In the language-specific applications.
And that will be, I think, in the stages which I can foresee, will be language-specific. Mm. And I think, possibly as a result of common experience over a period of time, it can be incorporated into some features may be found to be sufficiently universal to put into a general framework. I can't tell that. But I would be very unhappy if the view gained ground, and I think there's some evidence that it may be gaining ground, that all the functional stuff is soft nonsense. Mm. And that all that really matters in language learning is learning a new formal code. Mm. I think a development of
wouldn't
that sort.
Wouldn't that take us back to the 1960s?
I think
if
that
we
would
got there?
That would take us back to the 1960s, although possibly in a more sophisticated form. Mm. But I think that there is always a tendency to use your grandparents to hit your parents over the head. And so there is always a temptation for young people coming into a field to be very highly conscious of deficiencies in the work of their immediate predecessors and to reject it as nonsense and go off in a new track, which may in fact turn out to be the track which was followed by earlier generations. But that's a commonplace of intellectual development. But I would certainly hope that what has been achieved over the last 50 years will be preserved and built upon, and that though if work goes in a new direction, that new direction enriches our knowledge and understanding of the processes of language learning. In which case it is to be thoroughly welcomed.
And I'm somewhat optimistic in from what I've seen recently that the work going on in the area of the linguistic analysis, particularly looking at learner data, coupled with insights which are now coming out of second language acquisition contextualized in what they call instructed learning environments,
yes,
which are relevant to our discussion,
yeah,
may well converge to lead to insights which are not simply throwing the functional baby out with the grammatical bathwater.
Yeah. When we started work in the 1970s, applied linguists were a small community. We knew each other, all of us, and working in a world which is largely indifferent, if not hostile. Mm. But now I see from the Bar Mail advertisements that that the number of university appointments in applied linguistics, even in a time of depression and cutbacks, is growing.
Mm.
It's a well-established profession, and if it is properly conducted, it ought to lead to a considerable growth in our knowledge and understanding.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the future ought to be optimistic.
And I think what you've just highlighted is true, that interdisciplinary research now is not frowned on, perhaps like it might have been in the past, but indeed highly encouraged by many universities, which sees, you know, psychologists working with linguists, working with pedagogical people, for example, looking at the notions of cognitive processing, learning, language features, and learning features in a more joined-up way.
I think there's a lot to be gained from the studies on theory of mind. Because when we're communicating with other people, we need to understand how their minds are working. That, in fact, is in the framework, in the part that very few people read.
one of the dangers of applying a framework concept without fully understanding what it means is that you get requirements for people to have a particular level of proficiency, and that gets written into the law or into the regulation by people who fail to understand what it takes to achieve that level. So you glibly pronounce that anyone who wants to do this has to have a B2, or anyone who has to have that has to have an A2. And there are therefore social impacts for people who fail. This, I think, is one of the controversies which is being raging in some parts of the continent around the use of tests for migration purposes. How would you respond to that? It's presumably not the fault of the framework. If not, who is to blame, and how would you deal with this, if blame is the right thing, as a problem?
Well, firstly, I don't think it's unreasonable that if a certain linguistic proficiency is required functionally in order to do a particular job, or a political decision is made that a certain level of language proficiency is required for purposes of residence or immigration, I think that reference to the rather broad system of six levels can be useful. It is meeting a need. What then is required is that people who are imposing such requirements should be held to the implications as they are set out in recommendation 2008-07. And that people who wish to oppose that should think very carefully to themselves whether they are opposing the requirement of a particular kind of proficiency all told, in which case they should do so, and whether that is done by reference to the Common European Framework or not is irrelevant. Mm. They are in disagreement with it fundamentally and should develop their arguments accordingly.
Mm.
Or else they think that the reference to the Common European Framework is not understood or is bogus. or is a cover for arbitrary procedures, in which case they should hold the authority to account, but in the terms of 2087, which I think is quite clear, particularly taken with the explanatory notes in this respect.
Okay. And perhaps, of course, we come back to the problem, which is one for the, again, in the camp of the policymakers, who perhaps are looking for more precision or different sorts of accounting for level than the framework is set out to provide them with.
I doubt whether the users do require greater precision.
Hmm.
The demand for greater precision, then sometimes a greater precision than is appropriate to the use, comes from the profession.
Mm.
And people who are professional testers clearly want the highest standards to obtain, and that's understandable. But a six-level system divides language proficiency into very broad bands, which are defined in very broad terms. And the use and the interpretation should be in accordance with those facts.